Welcome to Smart Catalyst No. 9, 2018. So today we are going to see all these prelims articles. The first one is Prime Minister to inaugurate multimodal terminal. The second article is Government to sell enemy shares. The third one is Indian strategic petroleum reserves. The fourth one is Places in Recent News. And the fifth one is Advanced Motor Fuel Technology Collaboration Program under IEA. And the last prelims article is ready with locations, that is the telecom operators are ready with locations to conduct proof of concept. So the first article is PM to inaugurate multimodal terminal in Varanasi. So what is the news here is the Prime Minister will dedicate this multimodal terminal MMT on the River Ganga to the nation the next week. So what is this multimodal terminal in the sense it is the transport or the movement of the cargoes or the goods from the source to the destination by means of various modes of transport, but with one transport building. So here it is being constructed on the stretch of National Waterway 1, which has its source is Varanasi and destination is Haldia. So from Varanasi to Haldia, they are actually being constructing this multimodal terminal. So it is a part of Center's Jal Marg Vikash project, which means waterway development project. So this project is being implemented by IWAI, which is the Inland Waterways Authority of India. So what are the objectives of this project is, the first major objective is to develop the stretch of Ganga between Varanasi to Haldia for the navigation of larger vessels. Okay. And second one is to promote the inland waterways as a way to cheaper and more environmental friendly means of transport. So these are the main objectives of this Jal Marg Vikash project. And this MMT is a subset or phase one of this Jal Marg Vikash project. So now we are going to see what is this Jal Marg Vikash project. It is the development of fairway with 3 meters depth between Varanasi to Haldia. So it is from here to here. And it is the phase one covering a distance of 1380 kilometer. So it includes the construction of 3 multimodal terminals, which are the Varanasi, Sahibganj and Haldia. So it is being implemented with the financial and the technical support of World Bank by means of 50-50 sharing basis between the center and the World Bank. And it is also expected to generate 500 direct employment and more than 2000 indirect employment opportunities by means of doing this project. Okay. So you see here, this is the National Waterway 1 on the River Ganga from Haldia to Allahabad. So we have seen like the IWAI, which is the Inland Waterway Authority of India, they are only implementing this project, right? That means they raised a fund of nearly 340 crores by means of issuing the government fully serviced bonds. Okay. So by means of this only, they raise the money and they doing this project. And by means of doing this, it will change the way the cargo transport is done on the inland waterways. And it makes further easier to help the transportation of the huge vessels through this inland waterways. So this is the National Waterway 1, which is from Allahabad to Haldia. And this Varanasi is an MMT, which is a terminal. And if you go through this stretch, the transportation is being carried out from Varanasi through Patna, Bagalpur, Faraka, Kolkata, and then it finally reached Haldia. Okay. So it is the first multimodal terminal on National Waterway 1 with at a cost of 206.84 crores. And it has 3 multimodal terminals at Varanasi, Sahibganj and Haldia, and 2 intermodal terminals and 5 roll-on, roll-off terminal pairs and navigation lock at Faraka. So the second article is government to sell enemy shares, which is worth 3,000 crores. So what the news here is, the Union Cabinet recently has decided to sell enemy shares, which is valued at 3,000 crores, which is spread across blue chip companies all over the country. So why the government is doing this is to raise additional sources of revenue to pump up the economy during the election time. So first we have to know what is this enemy shares, and then we have to know what is this blue chip companies are. So this enemy shares is defined under the Enemy Property Act 1968, according to which any property which is belonging to or held by or managed on behalf of an enemy, an enemy subject or an enemy firm. So also by means of this Enemy Property Act, the government is the custodian of the movable as well as the immovable properties which is left behind by the people who left India before or after the partition. So whatever the properties which is left by the persons before or after the partitions, those properties are now coming under the control of the government, and the government acts as a custodian and it can decide what to do with that properties. And this provision is brought under the amendment in 2017. Okay, so in 2017 this act is amended so that to enable the government to liquidate that immovable or movable properties of the persons who are left India before or after the partition. Okay, so what the news here is, the government now trying to utilize this revenue which it raised by means of outright disinvestment of these enemy shares for building roads, generation of electricity and other public assets generation in the country. So these are the purposes for which the government is now planning to sell these enemy shares. Okay, so whatever the money raised or the proceeds which the government got by means of selling these shares, it is directly coming under the disinvestment receipts. Okay, so this money is being utilized for these purposes. And if you see here, this sale process of the enemy shares is monitored by the finance minister as well as DIPAM, which is the Department of Investment of Public Asset Management. Okay, so now we are going to see what are these blue chip companies are. So they are nationally recognized, well established and financially sound companies, and they usually sell high quality products and widely accepted products and services. For example, Reliance, Tata, etc. Okay. So if you see in terms of quantum, nearly 6.5 crores of enemy shares in 996 PSUs are there in the country, which valuation stands at 3000 crores. So this is what the government is now trying to sell. So the next article is Indian Strategic Petroleum Reserves. So what is mean by this strategic petroleum reserves? In the sense, it is you are just storing the crude oil in a reserve for future use. If in case any kind of external supply disruptions or deficit occurs in a particular economy, then in order to ensure the energy security of that country, they are just doing this strategic petroleum reserves. So as we know, India is the third largest consumer of energy and third largest importer of the crude oil in the world. So we obviously need these kind of strategic petroleum reserves. So under this SPR, the government has already finished the phase one of SPR by means of strategically store the crude oil in three places, Visakhapatnam, Mangalore and Padur. And now it is implementing its second phase at Chandikol and Padur. Okay, so these are the capacities of each and every crude oil reserves. So if you see in this picture, most of these crude oil reserves are located in the coastal areas. So Chandikol, Visakhapatnam, Mangalore and Padur. So if we see who is going to dig and store these petroleum in the reserves, in the sense, it is being done by ISPRL, which is Indian Strategic Petroleum Reserves Limited, and it is formed by Government of India as a SPV, which is a special purpose vehicle under Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. So the next article is places in recent news. So the news here is, the Union Cabinet recently approved for the signing and the ratification of extradition agreement between India and Morocco. So now we are going to see what is this extradition agreement. It means the surrender of a criminal to one country by means of another country on request from the host country. So this agreement is now being signed between India and Morocco. So as a prelims perspective, now we are going to see the locations which is surrounding this Morocco. So Morocco is a northwestern country in Africa, and it is, if you see on the right side, it is Mediterranean Sea, and on the left side, it is North Atlantic Sea. So this Strait of Gibraltar is between Mediterranean Sea and North Atlantic Ocean, and it is surrounded by Spain in the north. So if you see here in Morocco, there is a place called Marrakech. Here is only two major things had happened. One is regarding the climate change agreement, and the second one is regarding the trade agreement. So this is what called as Marrakech Accord, which is a set of agreements which is reached at COP7, which is the Conference of Parties 7 to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. So the next thing which is about this trade agreement, it is known as Marrakech Declaration, so of year 1994, which is manifested as Uruguay Roundtable, and later it is only get converted to WTO, which is the World Trade Organization, in the year 1995. The third important thing about this Marrakech is the Marrakech Treaty, which is for easing the publications for the visually impaired people visually impaired people under WIPO, which is the Intellectual Property Organization, World Intellectual Property Organization. Okay, so these are the three important things regarding this Marrakesh, which is a place in Morocco in African country. So the next article is Advanced Motor Fuel Technology Collaboration Program under IEA. So what does this collaboration program means? It actually aims to promote more cleaner and more energy efficient fuels and vehicle technologies. And it is an international platform for cooperation among all the countries by means of making use of the R&D, deployment and dissemination of advanced motor fuels. Thereby, we can promote more cleaner and more energy efficient fuels, and we can make the production, the distribution, as well as the end use related aspects in a very better or efficient way. So before, it was like only 15 countries are the members of this collaboration program, and now India had joined as a 16th member on May 9, 2018. Okay, so now we are going to see what is this IEA. So IEA is an international energy agency, and its mission is to ensure more reliable, affordable and cleaner energy for its 30 members, and it was established in the year 1974 as a framework of OECD, which is the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development. And as per this framework, whoever the OECD member, they should only be the member of this IEA, but not vice versa. And as India is not an OECD country, we are just an associate member of this IEA. Okay. And it has four main areas of focus. One is the energy security. The second one is economic development. The third one is environmental awareness. And the last one is engagement worldwide. So its headquarters is in Paris in France. So if you see in this picture, the IEA members are mostly Europe and North America, as well as this Australian countries. Okay, and we are just an associate member. And these are some of the reports which are being published by IEA. So the next article is the telecom operators are now ready with the locations to conduct proof of concept for KYC. So what the news here is, now the Department of Telecom had recently issued the details of procedures and modalities to be followed by these telecom operators while issuing new mobile connections to the consumers. So what the news here is, so we all knew that, so as of now, India's total mobile subscribers, so the total mobile subscribers base is now standing at 1 billion, it is standing nearly 1 billion, okay. So by means of this intensity, we can know it is the third highest number of internet users and second largest telecom market, as well as we are yielding more revenue by means of this telecom industry. But what the context here is, the Supreme Court recently restricted the use of Aadhaar authentication by the private entities in the absence of legal provision. That is, they actually restricted the use of Aadhaar authentication. So now they are looking for some kind of alternative instead of Aadhaar. So that is what this digital KYC process, okay? So what is this alternate digital KYC process in the sense? As per this digital KYC process, while you are onboarding the new mobile connections to the consumers, what you have to do is you have to get the live photograph of the consumers after validating the original proof of identification as well as the proof of address document. And thereby you can upload all the details in the digital database. So you are making everything digital. So, and as per the new norms, the Department of Telecommunications said only two mobile connections will be provided per day per POI, which is the proof of identification. So now we are going to see the mains articles. The first one is the political economics, which deals with the credit stimulus for MSME sectors. And the second one is the need for custom duty rationalization. And the third one is India's informal level meet with Talibans. So the first mains article is the political economics, which is telling about the credit stimulus for MSMEs. So what the news here is, the center recently announced a credit stimulus package for micro, small and medium enterprises, which are the MSMEs. So under this, what they are actually aiming is to sanction a business loan of up to 1 crore rupees within a time frame of 59 minutes to the MSMEs. And by means of this, the MSMEs will receive an interest subvention of 2% from the public sector units. So what is this interest subvention in the sense? It is the reduction in the interest amount or the subsidy for the interest that is paid by the MSME sectors. That is, you don't need to pay the entire interest, you have to pay a part of it. So that is what this interest subvention, and it is usually being provided to the government lending schemes and to promote a particular industrial sectors, like in this case, it is for MSMEs, okay? And also to boost this MSMEs, the government mandated to purchase at least 25% of their overall purchases should be from these MSME sectors. Okay, so why the government is focusing on credit growth towards MSME in the sense, because MSME alone accounts for nearly 30% of our country's GDP. So if you are using this credit growth as a tool, it can encourage the faster credit flow to MSMEs, thereby it creates the job creation, or it increases the job creation in our country. But recently, after the twin shocks of demonetization and GST, and after the IL&FS crisis, the amount of money which is lending to the MSMEs by the NBFCs are now getting limited or getting very lower. So in order to tackle that only, the government is now trying to implement this credit stimulus package for MSMEs. So if you see in this picture, you can see India nearly accounts for 72% of the business carried out or by the small, medium and micro enterprises. If you give more credit growth or credit stimulus to these MSMEs, it can obviously increase the employment opportunities and it can increase the revenue, as well as it can increase the domestic market's capacity. What are the concerns over here? That means by means of increasing this credit stimulus to the MSMEs, it is a good thing, but what is the concern over here is, it is very similar to the Mudra loan scheme, which actually aimed at giving or refinancing the micro units in the country. That is, micro unit business entities are being refinanced by means of this Mudra schemes. But it is not a successful one because it is troubled by bad loans, as well as in an interview, the RBI former governor Raghuram Rajan, he actually mentioned this Mudra loan scheme as a source of the next financial crisis. So that much negative impact it has. So also another few concerns are, these kind of credit stimulus may lead to misallocation of the country's productive economic resources. But it may also lead to the temporary boom. That is, in the short run, it may look good, but in the long run, it can lead to a painful bust when the stimulus by the government to MSMEs ends. Okay. And the third major concern is, it is likely to deteriorate the credit standards, as these kind of financial institutions are pushed or forced to lend aggressively to MSMEs. The credit standards may also get deteriorated. So these are the concerns. So what is the way forward here is, the efforts to expedite or to increase these kind of business loan approvals may be a welcome move from the point of view of growth as well as in the job creation. So the next article is the needs for customs duty rationalization. So recently, the second round of import duty hike was announced by the government on telecom equipments. Okay. So on the basis of this, we are now going to see what are the impacts of import duty hike by the government. So usually this import duty hike is aimed to curb or to reduce the imports, thereby making our domestic market more efficient. And it also aimed at reducing the widening current account deficit, as well as to check and maintain or make the rupee more stable. This kind of import duty hike is not only aiming to make our currency more stable, but what they are actually truly aiming is to assure the sustained reduction or to increase the reduction in import dependence from the other countries by our country. So what is the major concern over here is, as we have more domestic resources, why we are actually importing it from other countries? So that is what the major concern. When domestic resource itself is more than necessary, importing from other countries these kind of goods or services is not efficient. So this is what the major concern. For example, metals, minerals, all these things, we are having abundant resources in our country itself. So then why we are importing? So why means, this lopsided duty structure within the country, as well as the free trade agreements between the countries, makes a way which is very easier for other countries to dump their products into our country. Thereby, it affects our domestic industry as a whole. And one more concern over here is, the goods from the third country are routed through other countries such as the Malaysia, Singapore, which actually had agreement with India. So thereby, it affects our domestic industries as well as affecting our country's income. So now we are going to see what are the recent import duty evasions which is followed by other countries with India. So the first major evasion is dumping of the cocoa powder into Indian economy, which actually should be followed this value addition norms. But these three countries, they are not actually following this value addition norms. They are violating it and they're just simply dumping cocoa powder into our economy. So this is a major concern, right? And the second one is the oil and the natural gas import. It is now stands at 80%, But if you reduce it just by 10%, it can give you a benefit of $10 billion. So it is actually the aim of the government to reduce it by 10% by 2022. So the third major thing what we have to do is, our country already has a lot of untapped hydrocarbon reserves. So we should utilize that. We should make use of those untapped hydrocarbon reserves in order to meet our domestic demands. And the fourth one is, if our country follows the WTO guidelines and the change in the duty structure itself, we can easily cut down the import bill by 20%. So we should make it more stringent and we should follow it rigorously. So the next major point is, though we are having the fifth largest coal reserve in our country, but we are still importing 164 million tons of coal. So we have to see some other alternate options to explore this coal reserves. And if in terms of iron core, we are having like 210 million ton, which is more than enough for our consumption, but we are still importing. So we have to try to reduce these imports first. So by means of reducing this unwanted import drain itself, we can easily make our foreign exchange more stable. And by means of reducing the import of refined copper as well as the aluminium scrap, we can easily reduce the import of nearly $2.1 billion in the country in the current scenario. And if you see, in case of aluminium production, we are actually having 1.25 times the consumption what we require, but still we are importing. So we have to reduce that also. So these are all the way forward if we want to make our domestic economy more viable as well as to reduce the import. And if you see, in terms of iron ore, it is like we are having an agreement with Japan and South Korea, which is known as CEPA agreement. And as per this agreement, actually Japan and South Korea are dumping a lot of iron ore into our country. So we have to take sufficient steps in order to reduce that import also. So the last article is India's informal level meet with Taliban. So what the news here is, there they are going to hold an informal level meeting which is hosted by Russia, and from our country side, two former foreign officials are going to represent our country in that informal level meeting. So in that informal meeting, the Taliban as well as the regional countries surrounding the Afghanistan region are aiming to participate. Okay, so what is the main objective for this informal level meeting? In the sense, to bring peace in the Afghanistan region, which is majorly dominated by these Taliban. So if you see in this picture, these are the Taliban dominated areas in Afghanistan. So why it is important? In the sense, because it is the first meet where India sits in par with Taliban after the 2001. And it is the Moscow's second attempt to hold these kind of regional forum, because the August meet, which was held before, is fizzled out because of the opposition from all the regional countries surrounding the Afghanistan as well as the Afghanistan, by means of mentioning the relations of Taliban's link with Pakistan. So now they are expecting this meet to be a successful one. So now we are going to see what are the contributions which is done by India to Afghanistan. In the sense, there are three major things. One is, India helped to build Delaram Zarang Highway, which is connecting the Delaram district from Afghanistan to Zarang, which is in border of Iran. Okay, so it provides a way for Afghanistan to an outlet to the seaport in Chabahar, which is in Iran, and thereby it facilitates the bilateral trade with India. And the second major contribution is, India has constructed Afghan-India Friendship Dam in Herat province. And the third major thing is, India has constructed nearly 2,500 miles of roads in Afghanistan. So what are the concerns for India over this informal level summit? In the sense, India is feeling uncomfortable because these informal talks are taking place without the formal Afghan government participation. And it is the Taliban who is going to participate in this meet. But India actually wants any peace process in Afghanistan should be Afghan-led, Afghan-owned, as well as Afghan-controlled, and with the participation of the government of Afghanistan. So it is only welcomed by India. Actually, the Afghan government is not participating, right? So what the problem here is, India doesn't want to absent itself from this informal meet because it is hosted by Russia, and Russia is seen as a strategic partner to India. So we don't want to be left out in this dialogue. So we are sending two informal representatives to attend this informal summit. Thank you.